Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hi, it's our great pleasure to introduce Pasula to come to Microsoft Research and give us a talk. Pasula comes from Nepal, a very rare country, and one of our colleagues has went to that country and show us beautiful pictures of Nepal during her trip. I always hope sometimes I can go to that. She get her bachelor degree there. And after that, she continued and do a master degree at Thailand at Asian Institute of Technology. There, she met Keith Ross, and Professor Ross told me that he was very impressed with Priscilla's work and bring her to Polytechnic Institute of NYU. And this morning, Priscilla will give us a talk on attacking BitTorrent peers, a measurement study. Let's hear what she has to say.
And thank you all for attending my talk. The title of my talk today is Attacking BitTorrent Peers, a Measurement Study. This was the joint work I did with Xiaoxun He, Di Wu, Chao Zhang, and Professor Keith Ross, all of us at Poly. And Professor Keith Ross is my research advisor. This is the overview of today's talk. I have divided my talk into three parts. The first part is introduction, in which I will say about the basics of BitTorrent protocol and architecture. In the second part, I will say how different components in the BitTorrent ecosystem can be attacked. Specifically, I will focus on attacks against leechers and seeds. That was the major focus of our research. And then finally, draw some concluding remarks. Now let's move on to the first part, that is the introduction. I'm sure all of you here have used or at least know about BitTorrent. BitTorrent is a very popular peer-to-peer file distribution protocol in use today. It was initially developed by a person called Bram Cohen, and interestingly, Bram, I think he grew up in Manhattan. He developed BitTorrent in 2001, and he wrote the initial client in Python, but because the protocol is open, the different people have come up with their own implementations of the protocol. There exist several client implementations, the most popular ones being mutorrent, Azureus, and so forth. Now let's look at the basic architecture in BitTorrent. Let's say that a person wants to download a file using BitTorrent. So for that, the first step she has to do is get an associated file with the file she wants to download. That file is called a .torrent file. She can download such .torrent file from any of the available torrent web index web servers, examples being Pirate Bay, Mininova, ISOHunt, etc. So after downloading the torrent file, she will use a BitTorrent client like Azureus or mutorrent to parse the torrent file. And the client, after parsing the torrent file, will extract the information of another entity in BitTorrent ecosystem called the tracker for the file. And by a tracker is nothing but an entity for a given file, the tracker keeps track of all the peers that are currently downloading the file. So by contacting the tracker, the user's client will get a list of peers or IP addresses that are currently downloading the same file. After that, her client will initiate TCP connection with a bunch of these peers and then start downloading data from or the file from these peers. These group of peers exchanging the parts of the file with each other are called the swarm or the torrent for the file. Now, each file is divided into pieces, and each piece is further divided into blocks. Now, when peers share data, they share in the block level. They upload and download blocks with each other. Now, in any swarm, there are two different kinds of peers, seeds and leechers. A seed has a complete file. That is, it has all the pieces and blocks necessary for the file. However, a leecher does not have all the pieces necessary. So that's why, when transferring blocks, seed only uploads blocks to its neighbors or peers, whereas a leecher at the same time uploads and downloads blocks. Now, in order to notify its neighbors of the pieces it has, a peer will use a data structure called the buffer map or the bitmap. It is nothing but a bitmap that indicates what piece I will have. Now, at any time, a leecher is, as I said before, it's uploading and downloading blocks with its neighbors. For deciding on choosing which peer to upload, which neighbor to upload a block to, it uses a strategy called tit for tat. That is, I will send you data only if you give me data. So at any time, every BitTorrent leecher or a seed is uploading or exchanging data with at most n peers, n being a system parameter which can be set, which is called the number of upload slots. So n minus one of these neighbors will be the ones which are currently sending the peer itself data at the highest rates. This is what tit for tat is. And the remaining one slot is left for a random peer. If a peer is sending data to its neighbor, the neighbor is said to be unchoked by the peer. Now, as I said before, it's an open protocol, so there are several client implementations, there are several tracker implementations, and there are dozens of index web servers that exist today. And apart from this attack project, I have also been involved in another project in which we are trying to measure the scale of BitTorrent. So from that initial results from that project, we have discovered more than 5 million simultaneous IP addresses and ports, more than 5 million simultaneous users that are currently downloading files in the BitTorrent.
A question for this 5 million figure. I mean, BitTorrent client, although they speak the same language, they are not absolutely all compatible.
In certain aspects, for example, peer exchange. MuTorrent peer exchange is only understood by MuTorrent. Azureus peer exchange is only understood by Azureus.
So for this 5 million figure, does it cover all variants of BitTorrent or some major variant?
Actually, how we collected this is when the peers talk to the tracker,
yes,
they all use the same.
Okay.
Right? So what we did is we downloaded all the torrent files, like all 3.5 million torrent files. And for each of the trackers in each torrent, we ask the tracker for the peers again and again.
Okay.
And that's how we gather the IP addresses. It's a pretty large-scale measurement study that we have been doing. So this is the distinct number of IP and port that we observe. You know, if the same IP is downloading multiple, the total swarm size is much bigger. It's around 15 million.
Okay.
That's what we observe. So you can see that. Is that okay? You can see that the scale of BitTorrent is quite large and it's growing day by day. Now, who might be interested in attacking BitTorrent? As you know that, like any other file sharing application, BitTorrent is also being used for the sharing of copyrighted content like copyrighted music and movie files. So it's obvious that the movie and music companies would like to attack BitTorrent if that would help them limit the piracy of their content. Throughout the course of our research, we actually saw that some of the attacks that we identified in our research are actually being launched by the MPAA, that is the Motion Picture Association of America, and RIAA. So we actually detected these attacks being launched in real BitTorrent swarms in the wild.
So you mean you have concrete evidence these guys have attacked?
As you know, we saw the attack activity going on, but we cannot directly say that they are the ones, but then it's very likely it's them, because last year around some time, there's a company called Media Defender,
yes,
whose emails have been leaked. And from the emails, it's quite obvious that it's these industries who have been financing the attacks for the launching the attack.
The reason is this slide could have legal implications, and they have an army of lawyers.
Oh.
So just like,
we,
unless you have evidence, let's not touch the legal area.
We have published the same thing. I hope that doesn't create a problem, though. But you know, like, if you have read the Media Defender emails, that says a lot about the activities going on. So I think those will be the people they will target first. Okay. Thank you for the information. Thank you, anyways. And now let's see why it would be interesting to study about the vulnerabilities in BitTorrent. As I said before, BitTorrent is one of the most popular file sharing systems in use today. So designing, understanding the vulnerabilities of BitTorrent will help us design secure protocols for future generation systems. And then, as I talked to Jin before, some of the peer-to-peer applications in use today have an architecture similar to BitTorrent, best example being PPLive. So understanding the vulnerabilities of BitTorrent will also help us get some insight into the vulnerabilities of other applications. And then clearly the movie and the music industries who are launching attacks, they might want to know if the attacks are effective. If they think that the attacks are not effective, maybe they can cancel, abandon financing the attacks altogether. Now let's move on to the second part, how BitTorrent can be attacked. Now apart from the legal attacks that can be launched against the centralized entities in BitTorrent, like legally attacking trackers or torrent web servers, a more technical way of attacking BitTorrent would be to launch large-scale internet attacks against against BitTorrent swarms. In order to launch such attacks, the attackers can exploit the BitTorrent protocol itself to launch such attacks. As I said before, we have observed during the course of our research that these people hire specific companies who have expertise in doing so. These companies are called referred to as interdiction companies in our paper. The best examples being Media Defender, Media Sentry, etc. Now let's see how different components are, or what are the different components that might be attacked. So the first thing is you might as well attack the torrent web servers, or like Pirate Bay. If you bring them down, no one can ever download the torrent files and then download any file. Another thing is attack the tracker. If you attack the tracker, no one can join the swarm anymore. Yet another entity, suppose that you want to stop the prevent a file being distributed in a torrent. Yet another way of attacking the torrent would be to launch direct attack against the individual leechers that are downloading the file, preventing.
Are you talking about like attacking the machines themselves, or just like particular content?
We are talking about attacking a single swarm. Suppose there is a single torrent or swarm that is distributing, say, let's say the top box office movies. Then you can launch an attack against the whole swarm. In doing so, you would target specific entities in the swarm. So the third way is to directly attack the leechers by using different methods, which we'll talk later. And then the final entity that can be attacked is attack the seed. A seed is the one who is actually sharing the file, right? Or distributing pieces and blocks to other people. If you prevent it from distributing the blocks, the file will not be, the other people in the swarm will not be able to download the file. Now, out of these four entities that can be attacked, the major focus of this talk will be attacking the seeds. Our contributions for this research project are as follows. We identified several attacks that can be launched against BitTorrent leechers and seeds. And after identifying each of these attacks, we also evaluated the effectiveness of the attacks. By effectiveness, we mean whether or not the attack is can significantly delay the download at the legitimate leechers. And for that, we use two different methodologies. The first one we use is active measurement in real swarms. We actually join real swarms and then detect the attack and try to evaluate the effectiveness of the attack. The other method was we did some PlanetLab experiments. In that, we created our own private swarms in PlanetLab, and then emulated the attack, and then tried to evaluate the effectiveness of the attack. Now, since the major focus is today is about the attack against seeds, I will just skim through our results for leechers. For leechers, we mainly identified two different attacks, fake block attack and connection attack. I will not go into the details of these, but what we saw that these attacks were actually happening in last year when we did the measurement. It was actually happening in October 2007 when we did the measurement of these attacks. However, the effectiveness of these attacks, we saw that the attacks could extend the download time at the legitimate peers by a factor of not more than two. So we concluded, and we have a paper in IPTPS for the same, we concluded saying that against these attacks, BitTorrent leechers are quite resilient. Now let's move on to the major focus of today's talk, attacking BitTorrent seeds. The main idea behind attacking BitTorrent seeds is to diminish the seed's ability to upload blocks to legitimate peers in the swarm. Doing so will extend or lengthen the download time at the legitimate peers in the swarm. Now, it's very natural that this kind of attack is potentially effective in early stages of a torrent. when there is only one seed, initial seed, that is the person who actually started sharing the file. So there's only one initial seed, and only a few legitimate peers have connected to the swarm and connected to the seed. So, and collectively, the leechers have not been able to download all the blocks. So the file, the complete file, is only with one person. Now, we identify two different kinds of attacks against initial seeds, the bandwidth attack and connection attack. Let's look at both of these in detail. The bandwidth attack. The main rationale behind bandwidth attack is that unlike BitTorrent leechers, BitTorrent seeds do not use the tit-for-tat strategy for selecting which peer to upload blocks to. Rather, conventional seeds give priority to peers who download from the seed at the fastest rate. That is the conventional algorithm. And just like leechers, there's also one random optimistic unchoked slot. Now, the idea behind bandwidth attack is for the attacker to detect the torrent in its early stage when there is only one initial seed, and then quickly connect to the initial seed and start downloading from the initial seed at a rate higher than the legitimate peers. This means, as I said before, since most conventional seeds give priority to high-rate downloaders, that should enable the attackers to continuously occupy most of the unchoked slots at the seed, leaving very few unchoked slots for the legitimate peers. That means the upload of the blocks to the legitimate peers in the swarm will be delayed, thereby delaying the download of the file.
So this attack will only slow down the rate of multiplication of the seeders?
Yes,
but
yes.
Because the attacker pool is fixed resource, say,
mm-hmm.
and initially there is one seeder, so I'm slowing it down.
Mm-hmm.
But after a few hours, I have the same attacking resource, but the number of seeders have multiplied.
That's a very good point. But our point is, suppose that the new file has just been uploaded to Pirate Bay, and then there are only a few leechers, then if we are the first ones to connect and start attacking, the time it takes for the whole file to go to at least one other peer, I mean the time it takes for the whole file to go into the swarm, it will be in the order of so many hours, so that the people will be actually frustrated and would abandon doing. We observed a delay ratio of close to 10. That is, if a file needed 1 hour to download, it would take more than 10 hours.
So what I'm saying is it's only a one-time thing, because if you look at it from the MPA and other folks, I will come back tomorrow. I mean, it's just like, one day's
in that case, these will have to continuously keep on attacking. Yeah, that's what he said.
What I'm saying is the attack resource is fixed, but the seeders are growing over time.
Mm-hmm.
So the fixed attack pool will have a smaller and smaller impact.
As the
initially it may be 10 times as you say, but as the seeders keep on gaining critical volume, this
The basic assumption here is that if the first download itself it takes like 15 hours to download, then the people will actually leave that swarm. They don't. That's what generally happens in Pirate Bay. Like if you see a swarm and it's taking too long to download, you abandon it and then try some other torrent file. Right? That's a basic assumption. I know. I understand your point. That is that clear enough? That's a basic assumption. Because if you start downloading a torrent file and then it's taking you ages, you wouldn't wait 3-4 days again to try the same torrent file. You basically want to, someone would say, set a tag in the website page saying, oh, this swarm is too slow, there's no seed actually, or this is fake, or something like that. And they would basically abandon it. That is our main assumption. We
assume the seeder will basically give more rate to the faster download, right? That kind of behavior is easily modifiable. So I can say, okay, if I have 5 seed, I will try to, let's see.
5 leechers.
Basically start upload them equally to all the
So you can see in my later slides that not all seeds use this conventional algorithm. For example, Azureus uses, but they use some kind of variation of the algorithm. Yeah, you could say like, okay, this attack will not work on this seed, but let's go detail into the presentation and see.
Can you also talk about how to mitigate these attacks?
Not really. We haven't looked in detail, but I can talk about a little, because, I will talk about a little bit if you want to know. Now, that was the seed attack. Now, the connection attack. Now, the rationale behind connection attack is that a seed is nothing but a normal BitTorrent client, right? So, like any other BitTorrent client, it has a limited number of connection slots. This is client configuration specific, but for most clients, it's in the default value is in the order of 50 to 100. Like for Azureus mu torrent, it's 50. So the idea is, again, detect the torrent in its early stage, connect to the initial seed, the only one seed, and then try to occupy all, if not most of the connection slots at the seed. And then this would leave very less or none of the slots for legitimate peers. So, but one important requirement in this attack is that since it's a connection attack, the attacker should not have to spend a lot of bandwidth resources for this attack. That's why it's a connection attack, right? But however, in order to avoid being kicked out by the seed because they're not downloading data, they might sometimes have to maintain connections, they might have to occasionally download blocks.
So this is like a typical DOS attack. It's nothing specific to BitTorrent. It could go to a web server and similar type of attack.
But for the web server, the number of slots you would require would be high. In this case, it's just in the order of 50 to 100.
But it's like, you know, scaling down. It's like web servers also have a max limit on number of open connections.
Mm-hmm. But in web server, you would if you talk about the DOS attack, you would just make any TCP connection, and that's it, right? But in this case, you would continuously exchange messages, handshakes.
You have large downloads. You have persistent HTTP.
Yeah. In that case, you could consider it as a variation of a DOS attack. Yeah. Basically, the idea in attack is actually denial of service, both the bandwidth and connection attack, right? We want to deny the service that the seed is providing. So it is definitely, you can call it a DOS attack as well, but it's not exactly the same as a conventional attack. Yes. Yes? You had a question?
Could one identify just by the IP address?
But then if you consider a scenario in which attackers are attacking from the botnet, in that case it would be hard, right? That would be the extreme, resources that the attackers have. But none of the seeds actually have this kind of filtering thing. Now let's move on to the attack environment. For testing the seed attack, we didn't want to interfere in the real swarms. We didn't want to attack real swarms. That would put us into trouble. So we actually created our private swarms in PlanetLab, and we had our own attackers, own leechers, own tracker, own seed, and then we actually, you can call it, emulated the attack and tried to evaluate the effectiveness. In all our experiments, we have only one initial seed, which was located in our Poly campus. And we tested two different seeds, Azureus and BitTornado. In order to get deeper insights into the seed attack, we varied the upload capacity at the seed from starting from 400 kilobits per second to 4,000 kilobits per second. The number of unchoked slots in all of the experiments was set to 4, and the number of connection slots was set to 50. These values are very approximate to what normal clients have. We also had our own tracker, which was placed in a PlanetLab node. We used the BitTornado tracker software. Then in all of the experiments, we had 30 legitimate leechers, which were also dispersed in different PlanetLab nodes and were using the BitTornado software. And in performing our experiments, we wanted to make the swarms as realistic as possible. So we set the upload and download capacities at the legitimate peers. Specifically, we set it to the upload to 384 and the download to 1.5 megabits per second. We chose this value from your paper we have with Professor Ross. So we chose this value. We decided on this value based on the values reported in the paper. Now, for the bandwidth attack, we use 40 attackers in different PlanetLab nodes. And for implementing the attacker, we modified the BitTornado client. Specifically, how the attacker works is it directly connects to the initial seed and starts downloading blocks from the seed, but does not forward blocks to any other peers in this one. Now, since in the bandwidth attack, the attackers are supposed to have more bandwidth resources compared to the legitimate peers, we did not set the bandwidth limit for the attackers. Now, for the connection attackers, we launched 800 attack peers, but and all of them were dispersed in PlanetLab nodes. They use the same modified BitTornado code in which it connects to the initial seed and downloads blocks but does not forward to anyone. And as I said before, for the connection attack, the attacker should not have to spend a lot of bandwidth. That's why we set the bandwidth limit to 80 and 160 kbps respectively. Now the peer arrival pattern for our experiments represented a flash crowd mode. We started after the initial seed started sharing the file, we start five leechers, assuming that in most swarms, maybe a few of the leechers will already be ahead of the attackers in connecting to the seed. So we start five leechers, and then we start all the attackers, followed by the 25 legitimate leechers. Now, as I said before, we tested our attack with two different seed implementations, Azureus and BitTornado. Note that both of them are open source, so when we got the results of the attack, it was easier for us to analyze why the attack was not successful or why it was successful. So this slide shows the results for the bandwidth attack against Azureus. We tested three different values of seed uplink value, and for each seed uplink value, we repeated the test twice. In the figure, the delay ratio is the ratio of the average download time at the 30 legitimate leechers with attack to the average download time without attack. So this delay ratio represents the effectiveness of the attack in lengthening the download time.
You flip the slide back. I mean, just want to see, I mean, for that bandwidth attack, okay, there's no limit on the upload and download. So I'm wondering what are the attacker's resources compared with the the leechers and seed basically resource. So I mean, although there's no limit on the upload and download, do you actually, for example, try to record how many bandwidth attackers?
Oh, that was like I was launching the attack. So I, you know, in PlanetLab, if you choose nodes from like China, some of them would be like 10 kilobytes per second, right? Very less. So I was careful enough in choosing nodes that were, at least if we go further into the details, it was at least more than required, at least as much as required. I will talk about this later.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
That's a very good point. As you can see, none of the attacks were quite successful with the delay ratio of less than 3. This slide shows the seed upload bandwidth distribution between attackers and leechers in a typical Azureus bandwidth attack. The seed upload for this test was set to 800 kbps. You can see that none of the leechers or the attackers can monopolize the seed bandwidth. So the attackers cannot monopolize the seed bandwidth. That's why the attack was not very effective. Sure. So after 15 minutes, everything has been downloaded. So everything, there's no, leechers do not download anything. But the blue lines are for the attackers, but the attackers cannot get all the bandwidth all the time. That's why the attack was not so effective. Now to understand the bandwidth attack in more detail, we came up with a very simple fluid model. Let's represent B, the download capacity at the peer, at any peer, maybe be it an attacker or a leecher, by B, and let U be the seed upload capacity, and n be the number of unchoke slots at the seed. Then the download rate observed by a peer when it downloads data from the seed will be a minimum of these two values, either b, the peer download capacity, or the per slot bandwidth available at the seed, that is u by n. So this is the download rate that would be observed by a peer. Now let's look at our settings of these values for our attack experiment. So according to these settings, the bandwidth relations will fall under the following scenario. That is, the download bandwidth capacity of an attacker is higher than that of a leecher, but both the download capacities of the leecher and the attacker is greater than the per slot bandwidth available at the seed. Right? So in that case, each of the leecher or attacker, when gets unchoked, they will have a download bandwidth of u by n. That means both attackers and leechers are seen equally by the seed. The attackers do not have special advantage over leechers when they fight for the regular unchoke slots. So this was the reason why the attack was not so successful. Yet another reason is that, like you said before, Azureus does not use the pure conventional bandwidth first algorithm, the high rate algorithm we refer to as bandwidth first algorithm. It does not use that. By looking at the source code of Azureus, we found out that Azureus, when selecting peers to unchoke, Azureus prefers peers with one, higher download rate, just like in pure bandwidth first, but also two, fewer bytes downloaded from seed so far. They prefer peers who have fewer bytes downloaded from seed so far. So this is the reason why, even if the attackers have a very high download rate, because they will already, ultimately they'll reach a stage in which they will have already downloaded much more bytes compared to other leechers. The second criterion will be the thing why the attackers will also get often get choked, and the leechers will get unchoked. See, yeah. Uh-huh. Unless the throughout the, I think you mean to say, what if it gets disconnected, right? That's a very good point. It's throughout the, I don't know the exact time, but it also keeps across the disconnections. It also keeps across disconnections. Yeah. Thank you for the question. Now, do I need to explain the algorithm with a toy example? I think it's very clear to everyone, right? Okay. So I should, I'll skip this slide. Just to show that even if a peer has a high download rate, it might get choked because it will have downloaded a lot of data. Now, one of the reasons that I said why the attack was not successful in Azureus was because the bandwidth scenario was such that per slot bandwidth was lesser than both attacker and leecher. So we also tested the attack in this scenario. The per slot bandwidth is lesser than the attackers, but greater than the leechers. But even in this case, we saw, and please note that to realize the second scenario, we had to change the bandwidth settings a lot. The attackers already are assumed to have infinite bandwidth, so we have to change either U, N, and BL, right? And N is already low enough, so we didn't want to change N, so we ended up changing U and BL. The leecher download bandwidth was changed to 320 kilobits per second, and the upload bandwidth at the seed was changed to 4,000 kilobits per second. However, the delay ratio we observe is still very less. So again, the reason is the second unchoke criterion. Because the seed is doing some kind of balance, right? Trying to send data to many people, so that was the reason it was not successful. Now let's look at the connection attack results for Azureus. You can see that for all the three different values of seed bandwidth, the connection attack was very successful. The download and the leechers was completely stopped, as you can see from the second column here. For all the attacks, the download and the leechers were completely stopped. That means the leechers were not able to get the whole file. After they were stopped for a long time, we waited for like about an hour or so, but even in an hour, there was no progress, so that's when we stopped the attack. Now, this slide shows the bandwidth distribution at the seed between leechers and attacker. The main point of showing this slide is that we can see that this is indeed a connection attack because the leechers or the attackers are consuming low bandwidth, and it's indeed a connection attack. Now, in order to understand why the connection attack was so successful in Azureus, we again looked at its source code. Every 30 seconds, the Azureus connection management algorithm finds a peer that has not downloaded data from the seed for the longest time. Let's represent it by Tmax. If for this peer, if Tmax is greater than 5 minutes, then the peer is disconnected or kicked out from the seed. They call it the optimistic disconnect in Azureus, as you can see here. A peer who is initially connected goes back to a state of undiscovered peer by a result of optimistic disconnect because it was not downloading data for the last 5 minutes. Now also recall our peer arrival pattern. We start 5 leechers first, followed by all attackers, and then the legitimate leechers. So in the initial seed, in the attack, the 5 of the slots is taken by the legitimate peers. And since we start 800 attackers, so the remaining 45 slots will be taken by attackers, right? So what we observed during the all the experiments was that each of the five leechers that connected to the seed first gradually one by one get disconnected from the seed. And once they get disconnected, they can never gain back the connection slots in the seed. So after all five got disconnected, all the 50 slots were occupied by the attackers. And after that, none of the leechers could get connection to the seed, and then that's the reason why the download completely halted at the legitimate peers. Now,
let me see if I understand this attack and basically the mechanism that's used. So this seems to me more like a SIBO attack, right?
SIBO attack.
So attackers are taking different identities, right? And you basically launch a lot of identities against the SIBO. And since the seeder cannot identify the legitimate peers from the attacker, it has to treat them
equally.
Right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And now, the algorithm you are using, basically, you say, okay, I maintain a connection.
Mm-hmm.
I don't actually receive data. Am I right in saying that, or no?
I'm sorry, you are meeting.
I'm trying to see if that seeder algorithm can be easily changed.
Actually, the optimistic disconnect is for something like that, right?
Yeah.
If I see that someone is not downloading me, I'm just kicking him out. But this thing actually worked against the leechers, because this applies not only to attackers but also to leechers, right?
Okay.
So that's how they got kicked away.
I mean, let's say you establish a TCP connection to me, right? I'm choking you, I'm starting sending data to you. But if basically I observe you're not receiving any data.
Mm-hmm.
So I can basically just kick it out at that moment,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is the one modification of the algorithm which will force the attackers to at least consume its download banks.
That's what was one of the first points said. I said that the attacker cannot just make a TCP connection and sit there. It has to download some blocks. That's why even if low, the attacker still consume some download bandwidth, right?
Mm-hmm.
That is the main assumption. You cannot just sit there and not transfer anything at all. And the point you said that just, which one?
The graph of the bandwidth distribution between the attacker and the leechers. So leechers still get most of the basic bandwidth from the seed.
Mm.
Get some block and leave, or basically further distribute the block. I mean, basically downstream. I think the algorithm should basically work. So the thing basically this can be effective is this. So you have a leecher, right? I download, let's say, a few block from the seed. Then when I connect it to my neighbors, a lot of my neighbors is SIBO attackers,
mm-hmm.
right? So basically, I ask a block from them, I never get a response back.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's this part which is effective rather than seed.
Oh, you mean the leechers also trying to find out the attackers are present in the swarm?
Basically, the leecher and attacker are mixed in the swarm.
Yeah,
right?
And
so, I mean, in this case, you have 30 leechers. 800 basically attackers.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, this is a SIBO attack.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, among the 830 identities, only 30 identities
are true.
Legitimate.
Mm-hmm.
And the 800 identity is illegitimate.
Mm-hmm.
I think this actually shows the effectiveness of a SIBO attack
mm-hmm.
rather than attack on the seed. But the effectiveness is not at the seed part, because look at the green curve. The seed content actually has been distributed to the leechers.
Mm-hmm.
I would argue at the time of 30.
But the distribution stopped. Yeah, it was the rate being distributed was quite good enough, but it stopped, and the reason was the sophistication.
Not because of the seed. The reason is because of the SIBO attack. The content doesn't
mm-hmm.
get basically propagated
mm-hmm.
later.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I argue.
Uh-huh. We call it the seed attack just because this kind of attack can only be launched, and then the download of the file can be completely stopped only if you attack the initial seed. I get your point that the naming of the attack should...
My argument is this. The same algorithm, this algorithm will work in the middle of basically a swarm. So it's basically this.
By middle, you mean when?
By middle, I mean this. Say you are distributing a file. Let's say this file has already reached about half of the distribution stage.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning basically this file is already being distributed to a pretty large number of basically nodes.
Mm-hmm.
Then at that moment, I drop in the attacker.
And attack the it will still work?
Yeah.
I guess...
I
think it might not work because at this point we just connect to the seed right at the beginning. And if you increase the number of leechers, legitimate leechers in this case, it will not be effective because, and it also depends on the size of the file, right? It's also, in this case it was 500 megabytes. It also depends on the size of the file. Suppose the attackers were already getting this bandwidth, leechers were already getting this bandwidth, and then the size of the file was less than maybe 100 megabytes, then by this point of time, the leechers would already have gotten the whole file, right? All of the blocks would already have been sent out to the system.
Okay.
So in that case, before all the five of the leechers are kicked out, the file would already be in the swarm. In that case, it will not be effective.
No, I don't think so. I think basically the thing which stops is not because you don't have one copy of the file in the leecher swarm. I don't think that's the case. That the swarm
but if you have one copy of the file in the leecher swarm, there's no need for the seed at all, right?
Yep.
So the file will still be distributed. The file will still be distributed to the first swarm. So
my argument is basically for the later part of the attack, which shows to be effective, is because the leechers have hard time to find legitimate leechers out there to basically download the remaining of the node. It's basically this. I have only 30 leechers. And I have 800 attackers.
Mm-hmm.
When I basically get a block of 550 neighbors, most of them, my neighbors is fake identity.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, the leecher on the BitTorrent client has problem to sort legitimate basically client from the SIBA client.
Mm-hmm.
It's a SIBA attack that works. So let's move on.
We can discuss again.
Yeah. I have a question. So what the exact changes you made on the client side to do this
The attacker?
Yeah.
Just I said I would like to tell you that the attacker does not initiate connection with anyone except the initial seed.
Oh, okay.
Does not talk to anyone else. It doesn't even, in our case, we know the seed IP address, right? So it doesn't even talk to the tracker. That's how we modify. It's because in our case, we know the initial seed already, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it could be implemented in real swarm just by talking to the tracker. It can get there. So I just commented out the part of the program that talks to the tracker, and then just hard coded the seed IP, the initial seed IP address, and it just communicates with the seed. It was pretty straight. No, for that we just limit the bandwidth. I'm sorry, I didn't tell you that before.
Can you basically roll back to that slide, I mean, with the graph, take a look? And maybe you're trying to see. So my argument is basically look at the green curve, right?
It is pretty high.
Yeah, it's pretty high. You should at least have a copy distributed to the leecher already. Why didn't they continue?
Oh, I told you. The result of, I think I didn't explain properly, so this optimistic disconnect thing, as soon as it finds a peer that has not downloaded from it for more than 5 minutes, it will kick out the peer.
Yeah.
So the leechers were the victims of optimistic disconnect. Please note that the attackers were also optimistically disconnected so many times, but we have configured our attackers to be very aggressive. As soon as it gets disconnected, the attackers are continuously pounding on the seed, trying to get connection slots. So as soon as it gets disconnected, it will again gain back the reconnection.
But why would the normal leecher
checked out, and why would a normal leecher not download anything with budgets?
Oh, that's because there are five leechers. They would be fighting with each other and also the attackers for the unchoked slots, right? As I said before, the seeding algorithm of Azureus, it not only looks at the download rate, it also looks at the download amount. So that means the attackers will also go into the unchoked slots, right? So when attackers, and there are so many of them, when attackers take away the unchoked slots, each of the leechers will reach a condition in which they have not downloaded the data for the last 5 minutes. If the algorithm had been that it only favors high bandwidth attackers, then the high bandwidth peers, then the attackers will not have received the unchoked slots except the optimistic unchoked. In that case, it will. But then the Azure seed is trying to distribute trying to balance the data being sent, right? So having the high download rate itself is not enough for the leechers to continuously occupy the unchoked slots. Not a lot of them, but at least one or two of them, yeah.
At least one or two. Four slots. So typically, how many are occupied by the attacker?
It depends on the... you cannot say exactly at any time these many will be attackers because of the second unchoke criterion, as I said. If there are new attackers who haven't received anything, that will increase their probability of getting unchoked.
Yeah, but out of these four, looking from the seed point of view, on average, how many of these four slots are taken by attackers? How many of them are taken by...
I'm sorry. When I was monitoring the attack, out of four, I could generally see two attackers getting the slots. That's because the second criterion.
So effectively, the seed is just using always talking to two normal leechers.
Mm-hmm. And then it could be a different leecher every time, right? So each leecher will. The leecher is fighting not only with the attackers also, but also with other leechers for the unchoked slots, right? So that's why it reaches a condition, each of the attack leechers reached a condition in which they had not downloaded data from the seed for the last 5 minutes and they got disconnected from the seed. And once they got disconnected, as I said before, the attackers are very aggressive. So after they leave the slot is immediately taken by another attacker. The attackers are very aggressive, right? But the leechers are normal BitTorrent clients. Normal BitTorrent clients are not aggressive in connecting to a peer again and again. If they try once or twice, if not, they will just abandon, right? So they actually stop trying connecting to the seed at all. And then so they never get the slots back again, and then the swarm is halted. This is because the attackers are very, very aggressive compared to the leechers. So in summary, we saw that bandwidth attack was ineffective, but connection attack was very effective. So that means, now let's look at the results for BitTornado. First, the bandwidth attack. Even for BitTornado, the bandwidth attack was not very successful. The delay ratio is generally around 10%. Now, this graph shows the seed bandwidth distribution between leechers and attackers in BitTornado bandwidth attack. You can see that the attackers again cannot monopolize the seed bandwidth, and that is the reason why the attack is not effective. Okay. Now we again looked at the BitTornado source code to find out the reason, but this one does use the conventional bandwidth first algorithm. However, if you again look at the parameter settings for this bandwidth attack, you see that it falls under the first scenario in which the per slot bandwidth at the seed is smaller than both attackers and leechers. So attackers have no special advantage over leechers when fighting for regular unchoked slots. Now, so we wanted to see if the attack would be more effective because it's a pure bandwidth first algorithm, whether it would be effective in the second scenario. The per slot bandwidth is less than that of the attackers, but greater than that of the leechers. However, in this case, we did see that the delay ratio improved to about 4, but still we feel that 4 is not very effective enough because we have had better results in other attacks. So during the experiments, we observed that 3 out of 4 slots is always occupied by attackers because they have much more bandwidth compared to the seed, the leecher, and the per slot bandwidth at the seed. However, the leechers occasionally do get the optimistic unchoke slot, and when they do get, they can download at a rate of at least 320 kilobits per second. That's why the delay ratio is only around 4. Now let's look at the connection attack results for BitTornado. For the seed upload bandwidth of 800 and 1200 kilobits per second, the attack was completely ineffective with a delay ratio of around just 1. As you can again see, this is indeed a connection attack because the attackers are consuming low bandwidth. So we can claim that it is a connection attack. Now, for the case of attack bandwidth of 800 and 1200 kilobits per second, we see that the bandwidth relations follows in this falls under this scenario. The per slot bandwidth at the seed is lesser than the bandwidth capacity of the leechers, but greater than the bandwidth capacity of attackers. Note that the attackers have very low bandwidth in this case because we have configured them like that. So that means, since it is a traditional bandwidth first algorithm, the leechers will always win over attackers when fighting for regular unchoke slots, right? So that means 3 out of 4 slots is always taken by leechers, and that is the reason why the attack was so ineffective. The 3 out of 4 slots is always taken by leechers, and so they quickly download the file and redistribute it to other leechers. But for the case of 400 kilobits per second, you can see the delay ratio is a little improved to around a value of 3. This is because the bandwidth settings will now fall into the scenario in which the leecher bandwidth is greater than that of the attacker, but the per slot bandwidth at the seed is now smaller than the bandwidth for attackers as well. So that means the leechers do not always, unlike in the first case, the leechers will not always win over attackers when fighting for regular unchoke slots. That's why we have an improved delay ratio. Now, we saw that for BitTornado, the bandwidth attack was ineffective and the connection attack was also ineffective. So we tried to see whether, if we combine the attacks, whether or not the attack will be effective. So we launched a combined bandwidth connection attack. For this, we saw that the delay ratio values were pretty good. It was around 9. So let's try to see why the attack worked in this case. The bandwidth relations in this case is that the per slot bandwidth of the seed is less than that of the attackers, but greater than that of the leechers. That means attackers will always win over leechers when fighting for regular unchoke slots. So 3 out of 4 slots will always be taken by attackers. Now also note that since this is a combined bandwidth connection attack, as I said before, we start 5 leechers first, which connect to the seed, and then we start all 800 attackers. That means the remaining 45 will be taken by the attackers, right? So the ratio of attackers to leechers is 9:1 in this case. So attackers, because in the optimistic unchoke slot, the attackers often win over leechers, even for the optimistic unchoke slot. That is the reason why the delay ratio increased. Just compare this delay ratio with the delay ratio we have for this case. Note that all the other parameters are same, except for the ratio of attackers to leechers in the seed, right? In this case, it was 4:1, but in this case, it was 4:1, right? But in this case, it is 9:1. That is why even the optimistic unchoke, for the optimistic unchoke slots, the attackers are the ones who are getting the slot most of the time, and that's the reason why the attack was so effective. Now, to summarize the results for BitTornado, we saw that the bandwidth attack is ineffective, and so is the connection attack. However, the combined bandwidth connection attack was moderately effective. Pardon me. Now, both of the attacks that we talked in this paper, I'm sorry, both of the attacks, the bandwidth, the seed attacks that I talked today require the attackers to be able to join the torrent in its early stage and connect to the initial seed. So we also wanted to know if this is actually possible in the real world. So we took Pirate Bay as our example torrent web server. We monitored Pirate Bay for 1,000 new torrents that were being added to Pirate Bay. So we continuously monitor Pirate Bay. In many torrent webs. I'm explaining that. In many of the torrent websites in today, for example, in Pirate Bay, each torrent is identified by a unique integer. So for each new torrent that is added, the integer value is incremented. So just by monitoring the highest unused web page indices, suppose the last torrent that was added had a web page index of 1,000. So I start monitoring torrent IDs starting from 1,001 to 2,000. That's how you can easily monitor Pirate Bay. That's one way to do it. These days, most of the torrent websites also have the RSS feed feature, so you can actually subscribe to the RSS feed and get the new torrents being added. But for Pirate Bay specifically, we saw that the RSS feeds were being updated only a few minutes after the web page indexes were updated. So this method was a faster method, so we adopted this method when implementing our tool. So what we did is, as soon as the torrent was uploaded to the website, we quickly downloaded it, parsed it to get the tracker address, and then talked to the tracker to get the initial peer list. Now, the figure on the left-hand side shows the CDF of the swarm size when our torrent tracking utility joined the torrents, the 1,000 torrents. You can see that more than 90% of the torrents have less than 5 peers when our torrent tracking utility was able to detect the torrent. So this shows that, yeah, it is possible for an attacker to join a torrent in its early stages, which is a requirement for both of the attacks. Now, the second figure shows the CDF of the detection time. Sorry. By detection time, we mean the time between the time between when the torrent was uploaded to the website and the time when we got the initial peer list from the tracker. We can see that for around 75% of the torrents, the detection time was less than a minute. For some torrents, you can see that the detection time is very high. It's taking as long as a few minutes. The reason here is that, note that our example website was Pirate Bay, and throughout our research course of research, we have seen that Pirate Bay trackers are extremely loaded all the time. And this is because if you upload a torrent into Pirate Bay, one of the trackers that you have to use is a Pirate Bay tracker. You have to use a Pirate Bay tracker. So that is one of the reasons why the Pirate Bay trackers are extremely loaded all the time. So it takes a lot of time to be able to connect, make a TCP connection to the tracker. Also, because the Pirate Bay trackers are public, even people who upload torrents to other websites also use Pirate Bay trackers very frequently. So all the time, the Pirate Bay trackers are heavily loaded. That is the reason why some of the torrents could not, the detection for the time for some of the torrents was very high, because we could not make connection to the tracker. But the major observation is that these results show that it is indeed possible for the attacker to detect a torrent and then join the torrent before many other leechers do. Now, to conclude, from our leecher attack research, we saw that the P2P anti-piracy companies are currently attacking BitTorrent leechers. However, the attacks were not very effective, with a delay ratio of less than 2. In case of attacks against seed, both Azureus and BitTornado were resilient against bandwidth attack. Azureus seed was very vulnerable to the connection attack, but the BitTornado seed was resilient. Because Azure seed was vulnerable to connection attack, it's all obvious that it will be vulnerable to the combined bandwidth connection attack as well. And the BitTornado seed was moderately vulnerable to the connection attack. We also saw that it is feasible for an attacker to join new torrents before many other peers do and then try to take down the seed. So because we saw that since the combined bandwidth connection attack was able to significantly delay the download time, we concluded saying that attackers may be able to nip a torrent in its bud. That means try to kill a torrent when it's still young. So that's what we decide, at least for Azureus and BitTornado seeds. Now, apart from this research project, I have been involved in a couple of more research projects at Polytechnic Institute of NYU. The first thing is the thing I talked with Jin in the morning. We discovered an attack that can be launched against peer-to-peer live video streaming systems. We have a paper for that in SIGCOM P2P TV workshop in 2007, and then our work on attacking leechers was published in IPTPS last year. Then we have recently submitted the paper for attacking seeds, and then also, as I said before, I have been involved in a large-scale measurement project of the BitTorrent ecosystem in which we wanted to figure out things like what is the simultaneous number of peers in using BitTorrent at some time, what is the geographical distribution of peers, and so forth. Now, what we plan to do next at Poly is to, in all our measurement studies about BitTorrent, we have only been focusing on public torrents. So now we want to also find out what's happening in the world of private torrents, specifically the dark P2P darknets in BitTorrent. And then since we have figured out some vulnerabilities in P2P applications, we also want to shift our focus to coming up with good defenses against those attacks. And then also in all of the measurement work for BitTorrent till now, we have been specifically focusing on only the tracker side of the measurement. We have done some measurement already on DHT, but not extensive enough. So we would like to do more extensive research on DHTs in BitTorrent, and also find out how important the DHT and PX, the peer exchange protocols are, whether or not they can completely replace the tracker or not. That's what we want to study further. So with these words, I conclude my talk today. And thank you very, very much for your patience. And if you have any further questions.
Thanks very much for the talk. Let's thank our people first.
Thank you so much.
Let me ask a question. I mean, I recall a piece, I mean, your group also studied poison attack, right?
Oh,
I think
that was in DHT.
But you can even do that, I mean, for the basically BitTorrent torrent as well. Okay.
By poisoning attack, you mean taking a very popular file and saying...
I'm basically just submitting basically fake torrent. I'm submitting a torrent where the...
Oh, say it's a movie, but it's something else.
No, I basically just basically dump things into it. Basically say, okay, I'm submitting, let's say, a movie, Wall-E, or whatever. Actually, I mean, the tracker is non-existence, the CD is non-existence. I basically just put something there. I just dump another thing. So basically,
you say it's a movie, a brand new movie, but you just dump some garbage in there, right?
Just basically dump some garbage.
That would we refer to it, in our group. We referred it to it as a decoy attack.
Okay.
We think that this kind of attack will not be very successful because. For one thing, there are always administrators monitoring you. We tried actually putting decoys in there, but some of the administrators are very smart. In Pirate Bay, at least,
okay.
They remove it.
Okay.
They actually, I think they also check for duplications. I downloaded one torrent and then used some other name to upload it. We didn't go into the detail of that attack. We thought it wouldn't be so interesting, so it was actually removed. So the administrators are really working in there. So that is one point which would prevent such attacks a lot.
Okay.
Because, yeah, that was also one of the, we read through the emails of Media Defender, and that was also the attacks they were talking about. But the thing is about the administrators that they are removing the
okay.
the decoys. Yeah, they say fake. They have big words saying it's fake.
I can be the attacker can say that thing doesn't work, whether it's work or not.
Uh-huh, right. Difficult to manipulate a review system. So another question is, are you trying to find out how pervasive the real attack is, like in the wild?
Oh, we in the leecher attack, the seed attack, we It would be difficult to detect a seed attack, right? How would you know? If you had your own seed, then maybe by looking at the attacker pattern, you would be able. That's why we had to. One thing is we didn't want to launch our own attacks. That would be too bad. And another thing is it would be difficult to measure a seed attack happening,
yeah,
right?
But for the
yeah, but yeah, I understand. But for the leecher attacks, as I told you before, we first sorted out top 10 box office movies when we were doing our measurement. We first sorted out top 10 box office movies. You know, the attacks were so much happening at that time. They actually had blacklist of IP addresses that were launching the attack. There was a website called, that had, the attacker were using a modified Azureus client. They call it ZipTorrent, I guess, I believe, yes. And then they even had the attackers were indeed changing their IP addresses, but then they even had blacklist of attackers because it was so pervasive at the time. And we, at first, in order to test the prevalence of the attack, we first selected 20, top 20 box office movies. And then by initially just comparing the peer list for those torrents with the blacklist, we did the initial filtering of attacks and then came up with 8 or 9 top movies, and we saw that several of the movies were indeed being heavily attacked. Both of the attacks were being launched in, and these attacks were specifically targeted against Azureus and MuTorrent clients. We have found in our research that the most popular clients and use is definitely MuTorrent. So they launched different attacks against MuTorrent and Azureus. For Azureus, they launched an attack which is similar to the connection attack. They were launching it, and for MuTorrent, they launched an attack called the fake block attack that I talk about, just send fake blocks. So that those two attacks were really happening, especially in movies and also in music albums that were recently released. It's obvious these kind of attacks will definitely be targeted for new releases, right? That's when the things go out into the network. So those were definitely pervasive at that point of time. Right now, we haven't tested it.
So you mentioned the BitTornado, the connection attack is not a factor.
Because the main point is the seeding algorithm used. Because it's a pure bandwidth first seeding algorithm. Because the connection attackers have very less bandwidth compared to the other attackers, they can never get the unchoked slots.
So like of 50 connections, 5 of them are the normal leechers, and 45 are occupied by others. But these 5 have better bandwidth.
Okay. And BitTornado is a really, really simple client. You know, it has no connection management like Azureus. Azureus actually wanted to be more smart and then kick out leechers which were not downloading at a high rate, right? But in BitTornado, they don't have anything like that. Throughout the experiment, the number of leechers and for the connection attack against BitTornado, throughout all the experiments, the number of leechers and attackers were always constant. That's because they do not have the kicking out feature at all. So, one of the defenses that could be, would be, for example, in BitTornado, if you change the seeding algorithm to something like what Azureus has, in that case, the connection, even the combined connection bandwidth attack will not be successful, right? Right? The reason the will not be successful, right? The reason the combined connection bandwidth attack was successful because out of 4 slots, 3 were always taken by the attacker. And also for the optimistic unchoke, because of the high attacker to leecher ratio, they took it, right? The attackers were able to take the slot. But if you have an algorithm like Azureus, in which just having high bandwidth is not enough to get the unchoked slots, the leechers will still get the unchoked slots in that case, right?
So I think if you have both the combined approach, right, if the attacker just acts as a normal leecher, right, if they have a 10-to-1 ratio, anyway, they're going to grab like 90% of the resource.
For the optimistic unchoke? Yes.
For everything. And they're just the normal leechers, right?
they do everything exactly the same.
Yeah. That's true. But then still, the delay ratio will be definitely lower than the one than what we have right now. Right now, the three of the slots are always taken by attackers. But if you change the algorithm, they will not be taken by attackers all the time. So it will significantly be reduced, I guess. So the delay ratio already is not too high, right? It's around nine times. It's high, yeah. Of course, it's moderately effective, but then it was not as effective as the Azureus one. It was completely, attack completely effective would be the one that would totally stop everything. But so one way would be to, one way would be to change the, that's just a thought, maybe we could test the attack against by just changing the BitTornado code, change the seeding algorithm to that, similar to that of Azureus. But that is, again, equivalent to removing the optimistic disconnect in Azureus. Right? The only thing different in that case would be the optimistic disconnect feature in Azureus. If you change the pure bandwidth first algorithm in BitTornado to what Azureus has, then the BitTornado client will be equivalent to Azureus client without the optimistic disconnect feature. So for optimistic disconnect, maybe we could have something like, right now the Azureus client gives the highest priority to incoming connections. If there are connections of fee, as soon as there is an incoming connection request, it just receives it. So maybe one change to the Azureus client would be to have that optimistic disconnect feature. It's of course good to have an optimistic disconnect feature because in real swarms without attack, it is a good thing to kick out slow peers, right? So have the optimistic disconnect feature, but then after you have kicked out a peer, then you yourself go to the tracker and then get new peers and try to initiate connection to new peers. And then hopefully you will find some other leechers instead of your slots being taken over by the attackers themselves.
All of this, I think, is subject to SIBO attack. So basically, if a SIBO basically generates a fake identity, the symmetrical tracker. The tracker will have a long list of fake identities. And then when you retrieve the client.
Yeah, I agree to your naming of the attack. But what you were saying was the attack will still be effective even if you come in the middle of the distribution of the torrent, right? I think that might not be possible because by that time the whole thing will already be in the swarm and so there's no need of the initial seed at all.
You basically need to basically find and sort out the serial attackers from the regular leechers.
Yeah, another way of defense is try to find out the differences in the characteristic of legitimate peers and attackers. You would have basically, if attackers have access to the botnet, of course, you cannot do anything, but then generally attackers come from a small range of subnets, right? So you could have some kind of detection pattern, maybe just use some heuristic, give a weight factor to whether or not attackers are launching many IP addresses. You get many IP addresses from the same subnet and the amount of data they are downloading. And you could also have something like, I don't know how feasible that system would be, also have a verify leecher of your own. You call it a verify leecher. Put it in the swarm and see which of the IP addresses are actually forwarding chunk blocks to you. If they are not, then most probably they are attackers, right? So those could be the defense techniques one could use. So there are two strategies for defense. One is design a resilient algorithm. Just like I said, maybe make change to BitTornado algorithm and see what changes we can make in the algorithm. Another one is try to detect the attackers from their attacking patterns. Thank you so much.